It gives me great pleasure to introduce Colm Tóibín here tonight for all kinds of reasons. Apart from the intrinsic value of his work, there is a generation of Irish writers who are not well enough known in Holland, and I think this is a very important event for that reason. I'll just tell you something about Colm. Colm Tóibín first came to notice in Ireland, to me at least, in the early 1980s, the late 70s, mainly as a journalist and as the editor of two of the most important magazines in Ireland, in Dublin and McGill. And that was very important because Ireland was undergoing all kinds of radical transformations at the time. And Colm was one of the people who was really leading the assault on the old citadel of Irish society, the sort of the Catholic nationalist consensus which was there at the time. The poet Paul Durkin said that the real writers in Ireland in the 80s were the historians and the journalists, which is not something that a poet says lightly. The kind of work he was doing and the kind of work he was encouraging was very important. What was interesting about Colm as a journalist was his lack of judgment, in the sense of his lack of prejudice. He had an almost Proustian interest in the intricacies of personalities in politics. At the end of the decade, this movement in Irish society, which Colm was a very important part of, did eventually have a result in the millennial victory of Mary Robinson and the opening of a whole new chapter in Ireland. But apart entirely from that, at the end of the decade, the end of the 1980s, Colm published a novel called The South, a book which won a lot of prizes in Ireland and outside of it. And it was a rather surprising book because you would have expected something completely different from Colm. But it turned out to be a very finely written study of a woman in Spain after the Civil War. What was fascinating about it was one of the themes was a theme which will recur through his work later on, is the essential unknowability of another culture, a culture that you aren't actually born into. In his book, which has just been recently translated and it appears in Dutch, in the Sign of the Cross, he goes deeper into this particular theme. Another book he published towards the end of that decade, which is now very relevant, is called A Walk Along the Border. It's recently been reissued. It's called Bad Blood, I think, under a different title. It's another fascinating book. It won't say it's about the situation in Northern Ireland. It's basically about events and people along the border between the north and the south. And what's interesting about it is the total lack of solutions offered. He simply observes and comes up with portraits of people and their lives. He offers no answers and no explanations. The next novel he published, which has also recently appeared in Dutch translation under the bizarre title Lichtenlaye, The Heather Blazing. Again, it was completely unexpected. The hero is a middle-class Catholic nationalist judge. He's the sort of person you read about in the newspaper and don't take seriously. And what was interesting in this book was the way Colm forced you to take this person seriously as a human being and not simply as a political caricature. He brings you under his skin. You begin to understand more how certain kinds of Irish politics are based in purely personal experience. Another book which has recently appeared in Dutch is his study of Catholicism in Europe. Again, another fascinating book, because something that you tend to forget about living in Holland is the extent to which Catholicism is an underlying unifying factor in European culture. One essay by Colm that made a great impression on me when I read it in the 1980s was an essay about the visit of John F. Kennedy to Ireland in the early 1960s, which was accompanied by scenes of crowd hysteria such as never had been seen there. It was really the return of the conquering hero, the return of the playboy of the Western world. Colm remarked how he'd actually saw an Irish road on the TV for the first time. There was simply a shot of an Irish road waiting for JFK to drive along it. And he dates the birth of modern Ireland to this particular event. I was reminded of this essay recently. In December, I was in Ireland during the visit of President Clinton. And again, you had crowds of mass hysteria. The reaction was unbelievable. Again, he was a returning hero. Why is part of the reason we're here tonight is to discuss why. I'd just like to quote briefly from a speech that that Clinton made in Dublin on December the 1st, which he tries to explain why. I can't do an Arkansas accent, but 150 years ago, the crops of this gorgeous island turned black in the ground, and one-fourth of your people either starved from the hunger or were lost to emigration. That famine was the greatest tragedy in Irish history. But out of that horrible curse came the most bittersweet of blessings, the arrival in my country of millions of new Americans who built the United States and climbed to the top of its best works. For every person here in Ireland today, 12 more in the United States have proud roots in Irish soil. Well, the influence of the Irish in America is very obvious. In politics, you have Kennedy, Tip O'Neill, Tammany Hall, shouldn't forget. In culture, of course, there are the writers, there are the actors, the film directors, John Ford, Maureen O'Hara, Jimmy Cagney. You have the cowboys and Indians, also like Jesse James, Billy the Kid, the cops, the gangsters. You should never forget that the American slang for a police detective is a Seamus. The influence of the Irish in America is almost self-evident, but probably more interesting, and I think we'll talk a bit about it tonight, is the reverse process, the influence of America in Ireland. The strange way in which America is perceived in Ireland as being a player on the Irish stage. The kind of welcome that was given to Clinton is absolutely unimaginable in any other European country. An opinion poll taken in Ireland after his visit said that 90% of Irish people wanted him as president in Ireland. They might have had a few drinks before the poll, but again, in France, for example, you'd probably be shot for saying something like that. The other side of the coin is, for example, somebody like Eamon de Valera, the greatest Irish statesman of this century, who was born in America of a Spanish-American father, and yet nobody ever, for a moment, saw any contradiction between being an Irish patriot and being an American. The influence on music, country and Irish, as they call it, from American country music, the influence on the vernacular architecture, are all quite bizarre phenomena in themselves. An important aspect of Colm's work is the Catholic element, and of course, in America, Irish means Catholic, despite the fact that there have been far more Irish Protestant presidents than Irish Catholic presidents. In some ways, you can see Colm Tóibín's work in the tradition, in the Catholic tradition, the Deep South novel, people like Flannery O'Connor, the Faulknerian tradition, Cormac McCarthy. In a way, that's a more interesting way to look at his work than to look at it as anything belonging to the English novel. However, I won't speak any more about him or about America, and I'll let Colm say a few words himself. So.
I think that the main American influence in Ireland, since America began to have a really crucial influence there, has been, I suppose, cultural, in the way, you know, I find that somebody of my age, who's American, has seen the same soap operas, the Donna Reed Show or the Virginian, was part of their childhood in exactly the same years as it was mine. But I just want to dwell at the beginning on something else. The Constitution of the Republic of Ireland was put through in 1937. There was great debate over it. People talk about it as quite a Catholic document in that it recognized the special position of the Catholic Church. It forbade divorce. And people see it as a nationalist document in that it claimed jurisdiction over six counties or Northern Ireland. But there are funny parts of the document which De Valera, who drafted the document, certainly didn't intend it to have, which include a list of basic human rights for the citizen. And nobody noticed them at the time, there was no debate on them, and nobody paid any attention to them afterwards. And there was in Ireland a high court and then a 5-judge Supreme Court, very close to the sort of Supreme Court in the United States. But that Supreme Court never operated in Ireland as an interpreter of the Constitution. Throughout the 1940s or the 1950s, the law in Ireland was seen as the positive English law. In other words, what was passed by Parliament was the law. There was nothing greater than that law. And the job of the judges was to interpret what Parliament said, which was essentially the British system. But in the late 1950s, a number of nationalist intellectuals were appointed to the Irish Supreme Court. It took almost that long for nationalism to seep its way into the judiciary, in that the judiciary up to then would have been quite pro-British and would have seen the British tradition as being the central one. And in the early 1960s, just as what Michael described, John F. Kennedy was arriving, just as people were starting to watch American soap operas, the judges of the Irish Supreme Court in cases began to ask lawyers, do you have an American precedent for that? Because precedent was British precedent. Precedent were House of Lords cases heard, you know, the House of Lords being the final, the law lords in the House of Lords being the final judges. And Irish barristers didn't know what to do about this because they didn't know anything about American law or American precedent. But Ireland, of course, had a written constitution, just like America. Britain doesn't have a written constitution. And in about 1965, a huge number of books presented by the American Bar Association arrived in the Irish Law Library with all the judgments of the American Supreme Court from the beginning. They hadn't even been in the library. And people started to pay attention to this. So that what was slowly happening, as in the outside world, people were singing country and western songs in an American twang, and everyone was watching American soap operas, and people wanted to be American. And people were putting on American accents. I was in Galway recently, and I was staying in a hotel, and I met the wife of the owner, and I said, oh, I met your husband, the American. And she said, no, we're from Mayo. And somebody said, oh, no, but you did live in America for some years. And she said, oh, yes, but he had the accent before we went there. And so as that was happening in the outside world, in the very center of power in the country, the system of law was moving from a British system based on parliamentary law to an American system based on a written constitution, a Supreme Court which decided, and then in about 1965 or 66, it was a crucial decision, that the Supreme Court has the right to declare that there are rights held by the citizen according to the Constitution, not specified in the Constitution, which gives the Supreme Court then immense power. And we suddenly find a huge amount of things result, such as, for example, the first breach in the contraceptive ban came from the Supreme Court interpreting the Constitution in that way. The laws governing bail, the laws governing infinite number of things began from there, where suddenly Ireland turned from England. It's like someone turning in the bed from facing England to facing America. And I just wanted to start by just saying that Irish nationalists would view America as being good on their side, progressive and easy to deal with, and England as a much more complex and darker force. I was born in a small town in the southeast of Ireland, where my family had been involved with the Fianna Fáil Party, which is the party that came from the division in the Irish Civil War in 1923, was led by De Valera. It boycotted the Parliament at the beginning. It entered the Parliament in 1927. It took power in 1932, and it held power from 1932 until 1948, and again from 1957 to 1973, intermittently in the meantime, and intermittently ever since. So it is the most sort of powerful monolith in Irish society, other than the Catholic Church. Recently, it's had to go into coalitions for the first time, which in a sense the Catholic Church has had to do as well in order to maintain its power. The fee for a year as a student at that time was £100, and someone from home told me that he wandered in one morning and saw me sitting in one of the lecture theatres listening as a man talked about the short poem in the 16th century. I had my mouth wide open, he said. He did an imitation of me, as though I was listening to a piece of gossip for the first time. I studied English and history. In English, we were told, which was the currency at the time, that nothing of ourselves, of our personal experiences, should be brought to a poem when we read a poem. This was a system begun by I.A. Richards in the United States. A poem was a verbal structure, and our job was to define the nature of the poem. And this had huge political implications, because it suggested that a poem could be and should be and must be read in the same way by a student in Kenya, in Oxford, in Philadelphia, in darkest Australia, as in Ireland. A poem was a pure timeless object. Thus, Spenser's The Faerie Queen, written by a colonist coming from England at the height of its power in the 16th century to Ireland, and actually running the colony and suffering accordingly in Ireland, should be read the same way in Oxford and in Dublin. It seemed to me that was an impossible idea, but nonetheless, that was what you were required to do, and that's what everybody did. And in history, this was 1972, the car bombs going off in the north, the IRA beginning the campaign. The physical force tradition in Ireland was never dealt with directly. In 3 years, there was no lecture, nothing whatsoever, about the famine, the Fenians, Young Ireland, the 1916 Rising. History was constitutional history, administrative history. History was what Daniel O'Connell did, representing Ireland in Westminster. History was what Parnell did, representing Ireland in Westminster. And my grandfather had been interned after the 1916 Rising. And sometimes when the older generation of my family gathered, they talked about that as a sort of natural thing that they remembered. And the Fenians and evictions and black and tan raids and the 1916 Rising. But now in 1972, in the history department in the capital city of the country, this was unmentionable and not worth studying. A whole generation who had benefited from free education, which was introduced in Ireland in 1967 at secondary level and 1968 at university level, was being re-educated. It was being made clear to them that reading Edmund Spenser in Ireland was no different from reading him in England. It was being made clear to them that the real moments in Irish history, which were worth studying, were the moments when Irish orators had shone in Parliament. And this was merely a part of what was going on elsewhere in the society. A society was turning away from itself. And especially once a new government came in 1973, which was anti-nationalist, and elected by the Irish middle class, full of voices of reason, which were a new thing in Irish politics. In an effort to lead people away from the part of their heritage which was dark and catastrophic and violent towards the bright light of European Union. Ireland joined the European Union in 1972 and Anglo-Irish Agreement. I went to secondary school in 1967 then. In that first year, it was free. And I remember the budget introduced 2 years later by Charles Haughey, not because of the tax-free status which he gave to artists in that budget, which I'm very grateful for now, but for the extraordinary increases in social welfare payments, which were backdated and meant that a whole room in our house could be transformed. My father had died and my mother was living on the widow's pension. Every single piece of furniture could be thrown out. The lino taken up, the old curtains taken down, the walls painted, the old table thrown out, even the fireplace itself was changed. For the next few years, every time I came home, I could not believe this transformation. And then other things happened. Members of my family began to go on package tours to Spain for pleasure. You could lie on beaches rather than pilgrimages to Lourdes. And books no longer arrived from the Reader's Digest book club or the Catholic book club. The paperbacks by modern writers were bought anytime anybody from the family went to Dublin. My sister, who was just 3 years older than me, became addicted to Jean-Paul Sartre. I remember a book called Words, which began, "I loathe my childhood." And this was a really astonishing idea in Ireland at that time. Not long afterwards, another sister decided to build a house. And there were no architects in Enniscorthy, but lots of builders, and they suggested she should look at a book called Bungalow Bliss. And this explained everything about the new houses which began to dot our landscape. Houses which took their bearings from bits of Mexican and Texan architecture rather than anything previously in Ireland or in England. Tile roofs, picture windows. We went through the book and we began to drive around the countryside looking at examples of house number 5, because they were all numbered in different numbers of windows, or house number 62. And you cheer with delight when you find a house which you particularly favored in the book appearing in front of your eyes. So in tiny, unglamorous townlands, the Mile House, Brie, The Still, Brown's Wood, Boulevard, Davidstown, each of them began to glow with shiny new examples of what was to become indigenous Irish architecture. You selected your number and sent a small amount of money, and then the plans arrived and the builders knew exactly what to do. There was no damp in these wonderful buildings, damp being one of the serious problems which goes Irish history from the beginning of time. That's why the Romans didn't come to Ireland. And there was nothing to remind you of where you had been brought up. The windows were a new shape, which had never been in the country before, this way rather than that way. The layout was like nothing you had ever known before. They were like houses in America. Now you could stay in Ireland and be warm and comfortable and proud. In the early 1970s, as the car bombs went off in the north, and the debate raged over Section 31, for example, which banned anyone from Sinn Féin or the IRA speaking on Irish television or radio. The British had never thought of this, and in fact didn't do it until about 16 or 17 years later. So we were in there first with that particular piece of censorship and repression. And the nature of Irish identity was under constant discussion. Who was Irish? Were Protestants Irish? How are they Irish? If they didn't want to be Irish, could you be Irish? For me and my associates, the name John Banville began to have a strange and heroic power. His novel Birchwood, which was published in 1973, remains the most extreme and perhaps the most persuasive turning away of an Irish person from nationalism. In this book, Irish history was a huge joke, having been for 700 years an enormous tragedy. The famine and the War of Independence were mixed together with a circus and various Gothic horrors as part of a sour dream, as a narrative that almost had been prepared to amuse us. Banville's earlier novel, Nightspawn, was set in Greece, and his next novel, Dr. Copernicus in Middle Europe. It would be hard, it seemed to me, to write a novel set in the past in Ireland now, without somehow taking his novel Birchwood into account. But it was his attitude which mattered most. The prose was glistening with irony. The tone was sophisticated and knowing. The idea of viewing Ireland as a joke and the outside world as somehow real was hugely liberating if you were a student in Dublin in the early 1970s in a world dominated by Bloody Sunday and Bloody Friday. By that time, I had come to view Irish nationalism, the idea that there should be one single entity called Ireland, a nation becoming a state in which everybody would be Irish in some fundamental way, and difference wouldn't be an issue, but sameness would be what everybody wanted, as dreary, first of all, and irrational. It left no room for the variety and dissent I felt we needed, and I argued with my brother about this. when he mentioned how many times Ireland had been invaded and attacked, I was able to say that our family name was actually Norman, and that we had invaded Ireland. And if we wanted to be Irish as well, and we certainly did, since we were, my uncle had been a founding member of Fianna Fáil, we would have to accept the idea that we had invaded ourselves. And scoring a point like that became a crucial part of the early 1970s. I remember constant arguments, days spent discussing whether the IRA was a defense force or whether it should have stopped at a certain point or who was to blame. I remember that each time I went home from Dublin to this town where I was born, there was something new in the house, a fridge, a telephone, a stereo record player, new draft-free doors and windows. To announce one weekend that you no longer supported the prisoners in Long Kesh or the hunger strikers, and you felt that unionists in the north had a point when they dismissed the Republic as a small, guilt-ridden Catholic state. This was just to become another new and strange object that had been brought into the house, like the fridge or the stereo, part of the constantly changing domestic landscape. I wished all the time, and I still do, that I could possess the distance that John Banville possessed in his books and his reviews and his general manners, the Olympian, Nabokovian grand view, where the issues for a writer are issues to do with chaos and order and the cosmos. I wished I was French or English. I hated the arguments. I always had the terrible problem of seeing both sides. And as though I was standing above the whole thing, how inevitable the whole mess had become. Once that great plain in the south of England, those huge fertile fields in the 16th century began to produce a surplus, and there was room ready for expansion, and Ireland, the place the Romans called Hibernia, close to the word for winter, was so obvious and difficult to pray, how could they have stayed away? The world outside was glamorous. In Ireland in 1974, the Prime Minister voted against his own government's bill legalizing the condom, and not even legalizing it for everybody, legalizing it for married people, for family planning purposes, whatever they were. Ireland viewed itself as rural and Catholic. Dublin was in some way a foreign city which had turned its back on Ireland, and its heritage meant nothing. The Georgian buildings were British and were not there to take pleasure in. They were there to make money from. And all sorts of pasts were being taken away. The past that I believed in so firmly as a child was no longer real or good or even true. The past in which Ireland had bravely struggled, this little country, against the invader and won her freedom, which we now enjoyed, that was all nonsense. And the other past, that back room in Enniscorthy where I was born, the old fireplace, the lino on the floor, all that gone now, good for nothing, not a stick of furniture inherited or handed down, and Dublin slowly moving in front of your eyes, buildings being torn down. I wanted to get out, to go somewhere stable and free of all this. I would have gone anywhere, and I applied for a job in Algeria, but I was turned down. I went on a course for prospective members of the British Civil Service and was so bored that I couldn't go back there. In the end, I went to Spain. I arrived in Barcelona in late September 1975. I chose it because I knew people who had lived there and I loved when they talked about it. I saw it as warm and glamorous. And because it was not a capital city, I saw it as a place where I could be free. But more than anything, I saw Spain at that time in black and white. Franco, the police, and the apparatus of the state were pure evil, and dissidents were good. It would be easier than in Ireland, where these lines have never been clear. I was looking for a mainland, somewhere whose narrative I could follow with respect and wonder. Later on, when I published my first novel in England, the publisher rang up to ask, "Will you be in the mainland soon?" Mainland? "You mean England?" I said, no, we don't consider that the mainland in Ireland at all. I did not know that Franco was going to die in November 1975. I did not know, nor did anybody else know, that the new king, Juan Carlos, was a Democrat and took the view that democracy should be introduced not slowly, but immediately now. I did not know that the names of the streets in the old city of Barcelona will be put up in Catalan, the language Franco had banned within a year of his death, that many street names would be changed, that there would be a free election, a new constitution, that there would be amnesty, there would be autonomy. And if we were to concentrate on change in Spain in those years, I would be able to tell you that the way people walked in the street changed, the way they smiled and laughed changed. I would be able to talk about moments of supreme happiness in the politics of the city in those years, realizing that the Catalans were not going to throw bombs or shoot policemen. They were going to make deals, make pacts. They'd spent the years of the dictatorship educating their children and making money, and now they were ready to inherit the earth. They moved into positions of power as though power had been made for them. The climate changed, and yet certain things remained steadfast. The same people owned the same things. The Catalan middle class in the city of Barcelona, who had been affected by neither world war, in fact they supplied both sides in the First World War, and had remained aloof during the Spanish Civil War, became one of the few untouched bourgeois classes in the world. All of the men and women who hold power in Barcelona now came from that class. You watched change, and then you watched the notion of change crumbling in your hand as things remained the same. I went back to Ireland in 1978, and I found that if you listened to the language politicians used and the public discourse in general, with the trained ear of a literary critic, you found out more than any number of political scientists. In those years, Charlie Haughey was the man on the Fianna Fáil side, and Gareth Fitzgerald, who had been an academic and an economist and hadn't been involved in the sort of local politics or party politics much, became the leader of Fine Gael, the party on the other side. My father used to say that you could salute Fine Gael people if you met them on the street, but if you ever voted Fine Gael, that your right hand would wither off. And these two men, in their search for power in those years, made elaborate overtures to young people in their speeches in the early 1980s. Young people were always, according to them, our greatest national asset. Soon I understood that this meant something entirely different than it said. It meant that a great national tragedy was about to recommence in Ireland, that by the end of the 1980s, 50,000 young people a year would be leaving Ireland looking for work. And everybody, it seemed to me, understood the hidden meanings in the words the politicians used. Things began to mean the very opposite to what they said. I began to notice that if you put the word not in sentences used in public life in Ireland, which already didn't have a not, and if you deleted the not in the sentences which did, then you would get a much clearer view of what was really going on. I'd always been puzzled, for example, by the overwhelming support in a referendum in 1972 for the deletion of sections of Article 44 of the Irish Constitution. This read, "The state recognises the special position of the Holy Catholic, Apostolic and Roman Church as the guardian of the faith professed by the great majority of the citizens." And this is obviously true. The state recognises this. It was deleted by 720,000 votes to 133,000. But I realised it had been deleted because it was in fact true. Therefore, it did not need to be said. It didn't need to be in the Constitution. Most things in the Constitution were simply not true. For example, the Irish language, according to the Constitution, is the first official language. Ad not, not the first official language, and you enter the real world, that's true, not the first official language. Or, for example, the clause in the Constitution, "The state recognizes that by her life within the home, woman gives to the state a support without which the common good cannot be achieved." Well, the state recognizes no such thing. Thus, it was easy for the electorate to put a clause into the Constitution protecting the right to life of the unborn in 1983, in exactly the same time as the figures for Irish women who sought abortions in England were entering the European mainstream figures. So as Ireland began to have the same number of abortions per capita as every other European country, Irish people decided to put a clause in protecting the right of the unborn. So just as abortion was becoming an acceptable option, 5,000 women a year now go to England from Ireland to have abortions, then the clause could be inserted freely in the Constitution. The not factor explained things that I'd never understood before, like Eamon de Valera's extraordinary speech on St. Patrick's Day in 1943, when he said that Ireland would become, quote, a land whose countryside would be bright with cozy homesteads, whose fields and villages would be joyous with the sounds of industry, with the romping of sturdy children, the contests of athletic youths, and the laughter of comely maidens, whose firesides would be forums for the wisdom of serene old age. It would, in a word, he said, be the home of a people living the life that God desires that man should live. All you have to do with that is place a not very close to the verbs, and you get sense. And De Valera knew this, as did his audience. And there was the rest of us who have been attacking this speech and making fun of it over the past 10 years have willfully been misunderstanding it, accepting the letter of the speech as a way of attacking the Catholic right wing in Ireland. In general, everyone in Ireland has understood this not factor and has lived very happily with it. But in the late 1980s, the unionists in Northern Ireland... there's a page I'm missing now somewhere and I can't go on without it. Everybody's nightmare. Have it. The unionists discovered that they could get incredible mileage out of claiming to misunderstand it. And it is this attitude towards language in the Republic of Ireland which has been infuriating the unionists more than any pothole roads or statues of the Virgin Mary. And you see, for them, they call it hypocrisy, whereas everybody else just thinks that's not hypocrisy, you see. So it stems, in a way, a community which longs for the Bible to mean exactly what it says, feels it has nothing in common with a group of people, Catholics, who believe that the bread and wine becomes the body and blood of Jesus Christ, while at the same time knowing that it clearly does not. When the unionists use no and not, as they do much of the time and seem to likely to continue to do, we should underline these words rather than delete them. They mean every word they say, unfortunately. But in the late 1980s, they discovered that they could get incredible mileage out of all this. They began to demand that Articles 2 and 3 of the Irish Constitution should be repealed. Article 2 of the Constitution reads, "The national territory consists of the whole island of Ireland, its islands, and the territorial seas." And Article 3 claims jurisdiction over Northern Ireland. Now, everyone in Ireland knows that these articles are not simply meaningless, but they're best understood as signifying the exact opposite of what they say. In other words, Irish police stop at the border, and they don't go over the border, and there's an island called Rathlin Island off Northern Ireland, and Ireland, the Republic of Ireland, has never claimed jurisdiction over Rathlin Island and knows very well to keep away. And it doesn't claim any jurisdiction over Northern Ireland. In fact, it just does so in words, which is a different thing. But the unionists decided, as a way of annoying everybody, to test these articles in the Irish Supreme Court. Now, since the early 1960s, as I said, there have always been one or two brilliant individuals in the Supreme Court who understood this business, that some articles in the Constitution mean the opposite to what they said, and they've handed down judgments accordingly. This time, however, they decided to look at Articles 2 and 3 from the Unionist side, in other words, take language as the words of the Bible for what it means. And they stated that these articles represented a constitutional imperative, unquote. In other words, which would mean that it would be the state's duty to actually do something about these. In other words, go over the border, which nobody was ever going to do. And the unionists, of course, went back to Belfast screaming blue murder, pointing out that these things were worse than they thought. These articles were much worse now, much more dangerous. But everybody in the rest of Ireland knew that these articles do not represent a constitutional imperative. They simply looked at the Supreme Court judgment itself, and put in a knot and got on with what was going on. This way of reading Ireland, it covers a multitude, but it doesn't offer blanket coverage. There are very interesting exceptions, and it is easy to detect them. For example, the ban on divorce, which is gone from the Irish Constitution, which simply said, no law shall be enacted providing for the grant of a dissolution of a marriage. Well, oddly enough, that means exactly what it says. It is a fact. So unlike the article which recognised the special position of the Catholic Church, which was merely a claim. And this is why it has been so difficult to remove this, why the referendum failed in 1986, and why the referendum was so close last year, that people were actually confronted with a piece of truth in public rhetoric, which they found very difficult to handle. No one in public life much presents the verbal instruments to handle plain talk. People are much better at handling aspirations, half-truths, and pure lies. But in recent years, four new players in Irish public life have invented new forms of rhetoric. These are President Mary Robinson, Provisional Sinn Féin, John Hume, and the British government. The not factor does not help us to read Mary Robinson, who was elected President of Ireland in 1990. She is in many ways a political idealist, and saying the opposite to what she means would not appeal to her. This does not mean that she says exactly what she means. She never does that. She never says exactly what she means. She makes herself clear by implication. She uses symbol and suggestion with enormous zeal and cleverness, and people have learned to decipher her codes without any difficulty. So if she shakes hands with the Queen of England, then everybody knows she wants greater reconciliation between the two countries. If she shakes hands with Gerry Adams, then she signals that we will have to learn not to marginalise Sinn Féin in the future, but include them in our lives, all the more to tame them, or so we thought. When she spoke to NBC in America at the beginning of November this year, she said she was aware of, quote, the extraordinary changes in marriage law and the judicial separation that exists. So in a way, the divorce issue has now become an issue of whether the Constitution will be changed to allow the right to remarry in Irish society. Now, the anti-divorce people recognised immediately that this was a speech in favour of divorce, and they went mad, calling the remarks a, quote, unwarranted intrusion, unquote, into the debate. But supporters of divorce claimed the President was only stating the facts. Both sides are right. But the pro-divorce side is being disingenuous. When the President states facts, she's always pushing her audience towards a conclusion. Her audience know this, and they love the stealth of it, and the lack of the open hypocrisy. This is sort of hidden hypocrisy that they're used to, and this is why she always gets high ratings in the popularity polls. Provisional Sinn Féin adopt a different approach. They deal in euphemism, and everybody understands them too. Gerry Adams, Martin McGuinness, and Mitchell McLaughlin, from the time we allow them to come on radio and television, use the phrase the peace process all the time, use it over and over again, couched in a context of sort of passionate diplomacy and deep care. In Northern Ireland, to keep calling what happened, which was a ceasefire, a process, is to suggest that it might end. And since the only people who could end it were the provisional movement themselves, that when they used the phrase, as though butter wouldn't melt in their mouths, it included a threat. So when they told us that the peace process was in danger, this meant that some of the supporters would soon start planting bombs and killing innocent people. We understood this all the time, and so did they, but simply never said. And over the past few years, the British, God bless them, have joined the Southern Irish establishment in saying the exact opposite of what they mean. And this is what, more than anything else, what makes the new unionist leader, who was elected last year, David Trimble, look so angry so much of the time. When John Major told the House of Commons that it would, quote, turn his stomach to talk to Gerry Adams, he meant exactly the opposite. And when this became clear, that the British government were talking to the IRA, there was no fuss, no one minded too much, because everybody, even the English electorate, who always take things literally, understood him to, in the first place, to have meant the opposite of what he said. Similarly, when the ceasefire began, the British said that they would not speak to Sinn Féin until the IRA stated the ceasefire was permanent. Soon it became clear that the opposite was the case, that they would do this. Every time I heard during the 18 months of the ceasefire, Sir Patrick Mayhew, who runs Northern Ireland for the British, or John Major, speak about Northern Ireland, I placed a knot where there was none. In recent years, John Hume, who is the leader of the constitutional nationalists in Northern Ireland, his rhetoric has been taking its bearing from the language of prayer and chant. He has invented a mantra, and is immensely powerful and persuasive. We are, quote, a divided people, unquote. We must have, quote, dialogue, unquote, so there can be, quote, an agreed Ireland, unquote. That is all he ever says. No one can disagree with it. Like all good prayers, it works wonders, and he is a saint. The problem with all of this is that the four or five people who control the IRA take things literally and are humorless. So that as they listen to all this language used with immense subtlety going back and forth between Ireland, England, Mary Robinson, John Hume, they simply looked for truth in it. And when truth wasn't in it, they had no idea what to do, because their own language, as in their statements saying the ceasefire is over, is all always blunt and could have been written by a sort of computer. In fact, one of their leaders, Mitchell McLaughlin, who operates from Derry, looks like a computer. The discussion about how much Ireland has changed has replaced discussions about the North and identity. No one knows how much Ireland has changed. There has not been a revolution, and yet nothing is the same. I feel that maybe I've witnessed great change. I've been there and simply not noticed that a scene could have occurred in front of my nose, which was emblematic or important beyond belief, and I simply didn't just understand it. Maybe I was looking at the wrong things. By watching the Catholic Church so much, and the IRA so much, and the political party so much, we might in the end have misunderstood everything. I recently started to think about looking at Ireland through the views of marketing people, rather than, say, literary critics. And I talked to a man a few times called Peter Prendergast, and he is unique to marketing people in that he's responsible for two huge marketing coups in the Republic of Ireland. He first sold yogurt to the Irish people, and then he sold Gareth Fitzgerald, the politician. Now, I wonder how many people in Ireland can remember when they first tasted yogurt. I remember the strange taste, like sweet, thick buttermilk. I remember an aunt visiting and being told about it and shown it and looking at it. It was the early 70s, and there were ads on television for yogurt, and it was available in the local supermarket, and we had a fridge by this time. My aunt wanted to know if you could buy yogurt without having a fridge. If you consumed it as soon as you went home, immediately. We told her, yes. But otherwise, you'd need a fridge. And just as you needed a fridge to have yogurt, you needed yogurt to feel part of things. This is in a country which is essentially dairy country, where yogurt was deeply suspect because it was like sour milk. And yet, through clever marketing to suggesting this was part of modernity, and you had to have a fridge to buy it, then it became... And this wasn't true about other products. Coca-Cola was widely advertised, but we never had it in the house. Most other new products were ignored, but this was different. This was in some way a quality product, good for you, and brand new, like the carpet and the curtains and the stereo. It cost money, but somehow it was worth it. It was real and pure, but not too real or too pure. It was expensive, but not too expensive. Someone got his image just right at just the right time. Someone packaged it perfectly. It entered the folklore of marketing in Ireland. It is the sort of product that you can sell to an insecure middle class, and it spread like wildfire. In a short period of time, it boomed. It had never been in Ireland before. The brand name was Yoplait. In 1971, it sold 650 tons in Ireland. In 1972, 1,230. By 1978, it was selling almost 6,000 tons. And the marketing was done by this man, Peter Prendergast. And when Gareth Fitzgerald, who had been an academic and a sort of quasi-feminist and was a brilliant communicator and seemed not to have got his fingers dirty in the murk of Irish politics, became leader of the second largest political party in 1977, Peter Prendergast was brought in to use the same technique to sell Gareth Fitzgerald to the Irish middle classes, seriously causing his party to almost become the biggest party in the country in elections in the early 1980s. Once more, he had a quality product, new to politics and somehow outside politics, in a political world where women and young people were becoming serious consumers. He was open and friendly, but not too open or too friendly. He had a posh voice, but he cared, which was something new in Ireland. He was Europe. He was new without being too new. He has the same fascinating ambiguities as a container of yogurt. Modern, fresh, a cut above the rest, but good for you, would suit all your aspirations, would impress your neighbours, would look good in your shopping basket. The image spelled out a bright future. The selling of yogurt and Gareth Fitzgerald showed that large numbers of people in the Republic of Ireland, the place which was meant to be atavistic and backward-looking, would switch to a product which promised brightness and modernity and poshness, would even pay more for it and feel proud and good for having done so. Okay. In Northern Ireland, but the family home had become a cow shed. And it was really difficult when the Americans went to look at it, to imagine him going there and CNN coming with him. I mean, it was simply a cow shed, and on the ground there was what cows leave on the ground. And the old farmer wasn't enthusiastic about having all these people coming. There was nothing in it for him. Luckily, our nice Wexford family lived in a nice little house, so this could be photographed as being pretty and quintessentially Irish, and the cows were outside rather than inside. And that was... Then the bishop died on the day before, or the day of the visit. And this was a dreadful dilemma for the Catholic Church as to what you do then. So they simply kept that very quiet until the day afterwards. There was no public announcement until Kennedy had left that the bishop was dead, because this had to be preserved at all costs. Now, I was... this was the early summer of 1963, and I was just 8. And... my father brought me to see him, and there were two things about it that were remarkable, really. He was the first suntanned person I had ever seen. that obviously, you know, the Irish people didn't go on their holidays abroad, and the summer was never good enough for that sort of deep tan on your skin to emerge, which was extraordinarily glamorous. It was the only thing we'd seen it before was in the cinema, you know, that sort of extraordinary technicolor you got from Hollywood. We didn't have color televisions, and we didn't see life in color. You know, my memory of that period is that it was black and white all around us. And he was color coming around the corner in an open car. And you know, you got an extraordinary glimpse of somebody, and this tan was extraordinary. And we all wanted to be like that afterwards. And the other thing was, what you were saying earlier, there was a real problem that he had to go from Wexford to New Ross. And it was before the soundbite and the sort of expert commentator emerged in Ireland. So therefore, they had a problem that he was going to go 20 miles in a car, and they had no idea what to do. They could play patriotic music, but they wanted to keep people watching. So they simply filmed the road that he would be going along. Like, a car moved along with a camera, and you had Irish ditches, Irish fields, Irish asphalt, you know, what it looked like. But because it was on television, it was really riveting. I mean, it was really extra. He's going to be looking at that. So me looking at it is like me becoming part of him. And so we'd never seen the country so wonderful before. And it made his... There's an Irish playwright, Tom Murphy, who's based a play on a very real thing, which is that people tried to be like him then. A lot of people looked carefully at his body language and at his way of going on. I certainly worked for someone like that, who actually felt that he was, in some way, a bit of Kennedy. He moved around in that sort of way. And it gave Irish people a sort of funny role model, which, I mean, I don't know.
It was funnier than they knew, even.
Hmm?
It was funnier than they knew.
Yeah.
Yes. Later emerged.
Oh, yeah, because they also... Oh, no, there was... I mean, they Galway Cathedral was being built at that time after his assassination. And so great was the devotion to him that they put a panel with his face in it, in the stained glass of the cathedral, along with all the saints, angels, and the Redeemer. And the Redeemer. And finding out about him later on was like finding out that, you know, saints and angels had also been up to all of this. I mean, it was the most extraordinary idea. And, yeah.
I suppose you remember... nobody else would remember these, but in Ireland you often had these triptychs or diptychs. We'd have a photograph of John F. Kennedy on one side of a mirror, and the other side, Pope John the 23rd, facing each other. And you would find these all over Ireland in kitchens and in pubs. And I remember my mother, when the revelations about John F. Kennedy's sex life emerged, And I remember talking to my mother about this, because she had one of these in the kitchen with John F. Kennedy and Pope John XXIII, and she claimed it was all propaganda. None of it was true. They were just trying to beat him down because he was Catholic.
But John the 23rd? Was he out of his role? Oh dear, I didn't know that. I didn't know that at all. Oh, that's very depressing.
But actually, the funny thing, of course, about the trip in December was when Clinton was in Ireland. That was really interesting because he was trying to imitate the Kennedy charisma in a lot of ways, but it didn't quite come off sometimes. I remember when I was in Dublin at the time, December the 1st, when he was in Trinity. And at one stage, as you know, his mother was Cassidy, and he shouted out to the crowd, "There are only Cassidys here." And somebody at the back of the crowd shouted up, "Hop along." No family.
The Kennedy's thing was, anyone in the audience who has relatives in America could have put up their hand. Just everybody put up their hand. And, before Kennedy came to Ireland in 1963, the Irish government approached him through a representative and asked him, would he put pressure on the British government to deal with the matter of Northern Ireland? And you must remember that his father had been the ambassador, the American ambassador to London, to the Court of St. James, as they call it. And he absolutely refused and said that he certainly wouldn't do this. And then they lowered what they asked him to do. Would he simply do something, you know? And he said, no, absolutely not, that he wasn't coming to do that, and he wasn't. Whereas Clinton has been involved in the Irish business since his election in the most detailed way, that, you know, his visit had real substance, and he has backed up his interests with enormous amount of both diplomatic and political involvement. And but he's had, also because he's a Democrat and because he's younger, I saw Reagan in Ireland, and I mean, he was also suntanned, and he also, I should say, had a great deal of presence, which I didn't expect him to have, but he did have that. But he didn't have the same effect in Ireland, because that sort of, the way Clinton smiled at everybody and waved at everybody, and he just seemed young and glamorous and offered such promise and that sort of hope that Americans can deal with so well in all their, there's a whole sense of America being built on the notion of hope. And he certainly, I was in Derry this year when he was there, and he exuded all of that. People were really moved by him being there. And when he mentioned John Hume, you know, in Derry, was standing beside him, people, you know, he knows all about this problem. So I think that his involvement is a lot more serious and will have a lot more serious implications if he's re-elected than Kennedy's did. Although Kennedy's seemed to lift everybody out of themselves and begin the 60s, you know, with great hope and possibilities in Ireland.
I think it could have something to do with the emergence in America of the... the Irish Americans were always a very large group of people, but they never actually used their political power to influence policy making over Ireland in the way, for example, the Jewish lobby did with Israel. The Irish never did that. They never dared to do that. I think it's really only recently they've actually come out and started doing it and putting their necks on the line. There's a question actually from somebody in the room, which is, I'll just read it out, which is relevant to this. Could you please comment on the recent scandal surrounding the US fundraising for arms for the IRA, and what type of Irish American would support such an effort? It's another kind of support.
What happened is that really up to the early 1970s, the Irish lobby in America was emotional about St. Patrick's Day, singing songs, and being generally nationalist in a vague sort of way. The real trouble began when the real trouble began, which is when the IRA began their campaign seriously in the 1970s. The actual Dublin government had to become involved in trying to create a constitutional lobby in Washington of people who wouldn't support the IRA, wouldn't raise funds for them, wouldn't help them, but would represent Irish interests in a constitutional way on Capitol Hill. And they did this with immense effect. They actually even called the four politicians the four horsemen of the apocalypse. It was Tip O'Neill and Teddy Kennedy and two others. And so they actually managed, this is the Irish government, to separate the actual die-hard, dyed-in-the-wool, IRA-supporting side into the margins almost, and made the politicians much more responsible, respectable, and involved in trying to create some sort of, you know, truce with the help of John Hume. The The business of, I think the question is, the question, the question is, well, I'm, yes, no, 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 I'm coming to that. Yeah, I'm coming to that. The first visit of Gerry Adams to the United States was very important because it was during the lead up to the ceasefire, and it was about trying to create this man into a sort of statesman politician. It was for the cameras at home, his supporters, to see, look, they're treating him like a serious politician. They're listening to him. Maybe this is what they will do if there's a ceasefire. Maybe we'll get something out of this. And I was certainly in favor of the Americans giving Gerry Adams a visa. And the continuation of the relationship where Gerry Adams went to the White House, or where Gerry Adams raised funds, and they were very surprised, the Americans. They thought he wouldn't be good at it. And of course, he was very good at it, because what he was offering Americans was that it could raise funds for a political party, which he would try and establish, which would be all. So he got ceasefire weepies in. He had to pay him money. He didn't get people in to give him $1 million for guns, specifically. He got them in to build a political party. That was all during the ceasefire. I can't see how the American government could have stopped him or should have stopped him doing this. And but he won't get the visa to do it now, after the end of the ceasefire. And what sort of... There are... if you deal with the situation, for example, in Croatia, you find that there are Americans who are half Croatian, who are the most viciously pro-war Croatians, because they live in America, and their identity is in some way becomes this Croatian part of themselves. And that's happened as well in Irish America. I think it happens in every... I think it happened to Lithuanians in America in the same way. That obviously people who live away from where the daily life of a place become massively idealistic or massively antagonistic. Mm. And that's what happens in Irish America. I mean, there are Irish Americans who are more fiercely pro-IRA than anyone in Ireland is.
But it might, and some of those, the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse, actually, one of them was an Italian politician. But one of the interesting things about this is...
I just want to say one more thing about Irish America, just on my mind. This Irish America lobby is profoundly Catholic and tends to be sort of clean-living Democrats. And their St. Patrick's Day thing is very important for them. I attended the St. Patrick's Day dinner, you'll all be glad to hear, is run by the Friendly Sons of St. Patrick, is men only. I presume women cook, but they don't sit at the tables.
They're Catholic sons.
And so I was there for the first year of a breakaway group, which did hire, in fact, one of the trendiest places in New York to be, in the Putt building, and it had jazz rather than Irish music. And there were, you know, all the new yuppie Irish were trying to say, we're not going to be locked in this male-only, Catholic-only, you know, stuff. We're just not having it. And once that happened, once the first break in the St. Patrick's Day business started, there emerged a very serious and committed gay and lesbian lobby in New York who wanted to march as gay and lesbian people on St. Patrick's Day with the Irish parade. They were Irish. And this was the banner under which they felt most comfortable. Most people prefer to be from Longford or to march behind, you know, Dublin, and you march behind Dublin. I marched one year, years ago, behind, I got lost, I couldn't find the Wexford one, so I got behind Westmeath. And, it was a disaster, but, I mean, you've no idea. But the Irish Americans decided to stop the gay and lesbian people doing this. And these were new, recent Irish immigrants in New York versus a lobby which was saying, no, to be Irish is to be Catholic, to be Irish is to be straight, or at least, you know, pretend you're straight. And these people are just not marching with us. And they actually went to the Supreme Court to stop this. And I remember being on a radio program in what's called one of the ethnic stations, the Irish station, just saying, you can go on with this if you like with your parade, but don't come to Ireland with it. Don't expect anyone in Ireland to have any sympathy for you with your, intolerance. That Ireland's changing all the time, and that you can't continue this male-only anti-gay prejudice, you know, and represent Ireland with it. But the interviewers attacked me bitterly and said that, you know, who do these people think they were? Well, they're Irish.
Hmm. well, it actually reminds me of St. Patrick's Day in the 1960s in Ireland, which was a very, very strange thing, is, of course, that in Ireland in the 60s, St. Patrick's Day wasn't actually celebrated as a great national holiday. It was rather boring. But there was one thing, which was the cheerleaders from America, Irish-American cheerleaders. And I think a whole generation of Irish males discovered sex, basically, through watching cheerleaders on St. Patrick's Day. But the funny thing about St. Patrick's Day is, a few years ago, I was working in Amsterdam. I was teaching in an international school, which was an American school. I remember going into school one day, and everybody was wearing green. I had shamrock all over them. And I think, what's going on? They said, it was St. Patrick's Day. And it was like a national American holiday. And that points to one of the strange things about the Irish in America, is you can be, as I was saying with De Valera, you can be Irish and American, and to some extent, to be American is to be a little bit Irish, which is very bizarre, because you can't be American and be a little bit Croatian in the same way.
That's true.
The mainstream in America, if you look at American movies, somebody who has his name is De Niro is Italian, so it means something. But somebody whose name is Sullivan, it's just your ordinary Joe. It's kind of like the mainstream, it's not ethnic. So the Irish have the luxury in America of being ethnic and non-ethnic at the same time. It's a very strange position to be in, I think. I think that could be the reason why Irish Americans have not used their influence on politics in Ireland. To do so would be to establish themselves as an ethnic group, whereas they've been trying for a long time not to be an ethnic group.
Yes, but that's what America was, to have that.
Like the black Irish people in America and so on. This is a story from a black Irishman. They do exist, from Dublin, went to America, went to New York, and went into Irish pubs, and people kept looking at him, saying, don't you feel a bit out of place here, a bit uncomfortable? So he kept having to take out his passport and show them that he was Irish. I was actually born in Ireland, whereas they weren't. So he was Irish, despite the fact that he was blacker than anybody had ever seen in New York. So I think the whole thing is a minefield. I wanted to throw a quote at you, which I just found today. I was looking through a book by an Irish journalist, Fintan O'Toole, and it's an essay about the Irish in America. And he has a great quote that he found from the Times, the London Times, in 1865, where it says, "A Catholic Celt or Celt will soon be as rare on the banks of the Shannon as a red Indian on the shores of the Manhattan," which was a very interesting idea. The idea that the Irish were like red Indians. And then the Irish went to America. They were Indians in Ireland, and they went to America and became cowboys. I remember Seamus Heaney once saying, when people in Massachusetts asked him to explain the Irish situation, the Northern Irish situation, he always said to them, try and imagine a situation where English settlers, Dutch settlers, went to Massachusetts and did not exterminate all the native Indians. Worse, the native Indians are still a majority. And he said that always shut them up completely. They never had any more questions after that. The Irish attitude to America is ambiguous in that sense, because we are Indians, we're red Indians, we're a colonized people. We go to America and suddenly we're white men. It must have an effect.
Yeah, I used to love that bit in the movie when, the Indian would appear behind the boulder. And the arrow would come, and they'd be going, oh, there's going to be, bareback riding and pure excitement from now on. It never struck me that that is actually the business, the beginning, of the colonial drama, where the white man has sort of reason and technology and need, and the native has an aboriginal relationship with the landscape and no technology and a fierce belief that this land is fundamentally his or hers. But I never realized watching the movie there was that, and there is that huge ambiguity going back into Ireland as to who's an Indian and who's one of the funny things that happens, if you go to Sicily, you see people with red hair in the street, and the part of the cathedral is actually a Norman keep built by the Normans, who also came to Ireland at the same time as they went to Sicily. They were vicious. Any island at all, they would go to. And you get similar mixes in Sicily, say, or in... Similarly, Ireland has always been a place that people invaded. The idea of there being natives
is really ridiculous, and things mixed in a most sort of wonderful way. And it's only, you know, with the 16th century invasion, or the Cromwellian invasion, and the sort of creation of romantic nationalism in the 19th century, that actually created this notion that there was an Irish race, because I wouldn't accept that at all.
No.
And as I say, if there is an Irish race, well, I'm Irish, and I'm also descended from Normans who invaded Ireland, which means I must have at some point in my life invaded myself, which, you know, has possibilities, but I...
Yeah. But the funny thing is that you would imagine, given those circumstances, that the Irish in America would be the most liberal and would be the ones who would be most opposed to American expansion in the world and would have a special feeling, for example, with South America. And yet they don't seem to. They seem to always be on the right wing in America.
Yes, there was a very funny situation where, particularly against Ronald Reagan's policy in Central America, a great number of Irish nuns and priests had worked there and really felt that American policy was wrong. And because in Ireland everyone's always arguing about everything and people feel that Ireland's always to blame in some way for things, they saw no difficulty picketing the American embassy. That's what they would naturally do. But Americans and some Irish supporters of America began to see this as a virulent anti-Americanism taking root in Ireland of all places, which wasn't about that at all. It was about that the natural business in Ireland is to go and protest wherever things are happening. And that the nuns were coming home to say, you know, that they're doing to the, whatever, the people in El Salvador, to the actual peasants, what Cromwell did in Ireland. And people were saying, you know, the picking the American embassy meant nothing except that Ireland felt it was American. And that picking the American embassy was like protesting in your own country. But Americans don't see, particularly in relation to foreign policy, they don't see things like that at all.
No.
And it was a complete misunderstanding, and it was sort of wonderful to watch at the time, thinking, how could you explain this one side to the other? We don't really mean any harm against America, just against this particular instance now. Nothing personal.
Yeah. There's an interesting question, actually, which was has to do with language. And I don't know who asked it, but somebody in the hall. It's quite fascinating. Do you think the Unionists are reluctant to join ERA for primarily philosophic... I'm as exemplified by viability to cope with your something factor? You're not factor.
Oh, my not factor.
Not factor, yeah. Or economic, that is more unemployment, low pay packet reasons. And what I find interesting with this question is ERA. I mean, where is ERA? What is ERA? I don't know, I've never seen it. I mean, it's a word that kind of came into existence because if you talk, ERA is the, it was at one stage, according to the Constitution, the official name of the Republic of Ireland. But ERA is also a word which means the whole island of Ireland. So the ambiguity, the not situation, is built into the very word because Ireland is not ERA. I don't want to join ERA. Nobody in his right mind would ever want to join ERA. So why would the Unionists do so?
I will just hold on a minute now.
I'm sorry, I didn't see that. I used the word ERA as the whole island. But the point I want to make is that as a Brit, I have to say lots of my best friends are Irish, and I love hearing them in their books. And there's a lot of us in the same position with lots of sympathy, even with the things that have happened recently. But I often feel that the fears of Northern Irish people in joining up with the Southern Irish, in whatever hole you like to call it, are quite as much economic. They're quite afraid they're going to get less money in their paper packets than over the ideas, as you say. Ireland as a concept has changed enormously over 20 years, but they still don't want to join. What's changed? Not the economic
That philosophy is actually known in Ireland as loyal to the crown, loyal to the half crown. I don't know if it's feasible or not. My own feeling is that it's not. That's not really true. That even if the Republic was richer economically than the North, the problem would be exactly the same for the Unionists.
Can I just go on about this for a bit? In 1869, 100,000 people were born again in Northern Ireland as born-again Christians. It was a huge movement. And this date and this event is not recorded in any of the school books or in any other thing, that it's as though it happened in a century where, you know, the famine happened and where the story was already written, that it was to be Irish nationalism moving through tragedy towards triumph. And this notion that in ordinary people, in small farms all around Fermanagh, all around those places, people moved away from the established church into small churches of their own and read the Bible more or less in private, in very small groups. And when I came across this first, when I was writing the book about the border, I went to visit a man called Pastor Bain, whose church had been shot on a Sunday when they were at his born-again, very small church, by a breakaway group from the IRA called the INLA, which shot the church and killed two men from the congregation. Just because it was near the border and because it was sort of newsworthy, I went just to see him. And I found a whole sort of kindness towards me and a whole view of the world which had nothing to do with unionists on the television or to do with no surrender or to do with all that hardness. These people were intense Christians and they were very much locked into prayer meetings, Bible meetings, and their small farming. And really matters like, you know, and obviously they voted unionist because that was they felt that in any other, that was where they belonged in some way, was in the state of Northern Ireland where these things were allowed to happen through the nature of the British state, where religious tolerance and groups like that were left alone, which they mightn't be in the Republic, where, for example, they would have real difficulty with schools, say, where there would be either Catholic or Protestant schools. Anyway, they just felt that the... And I he kept thinking, just because I was listening to him so closely, that he was going to convert me. And so, as a result, I saw him quite a bit. And the first time I phoned him, I said that I wanted to meet him. And he said, well, I have two questions to ask you. Are you in the INLA? Oh, I said, no. He said, that's good because they shot us, you know. So I said, well, I'm not in there. Are you prepared to be born again? So I didn't know what to say to that. I said, well, not at the moment. It wasn't actually what I was. Well, you know, you must be born again. And anyway, I just liked him. And as you move through that world, if you're on your own and you've no views one way or the other on it, you meet a lot of people, both middle class and small farmers, who really are not in any way close to the politicians who represent them, who desperately don't want to be in the Republic of Ireland, as I desperately don't want to be carrying an English or British passport. If someone said to me, would you like to be reunited with the mother country or with England, I would say, I do not. And I would expect everyone to understand those rights of mine. So you say, well, if there are people in Northern Ireland who don't want to be part of the Republic, that seems perfectly reasonable to me. They're in a majority now. They may not always be. My view is that as long as there is any number, any sizable number of people in Northern Ireland who want to be British, they must have that right in perpetuity. It's not just about majorities. And in making that argument, I would then say Northern Ireland is divided more or less, 60-40. Protestant, like a unionist nationalist. Yeah, it's moving closer, but some of the nationalists are getting very unionist as well, you know, because they're getting richer and they just are more involved in the British state. But anyway, whatever that figure is, that the nationalist rights to want to be Irish must also be respected, that there must be some way of dealing with this whereby, for example, everybody knows what areas are Protestant and Catholic. Everybody knows them, even though it might change with just one wall or just one piece of the road. So it's quite possible to police the place very sensitively and carefully, but you tend to have a local police force operating which people respect and deal with. You can deal with flags very easily just by having no flag or a European flag. You know, everything can be dealt with. And all has to happen is that everyone has to decide, the other side, have immense and almost rights in perpetuity. Now, why the unionists don't want to come into the Republic, there are, I mean, you know, very simple matters. I have a friend who had a stillbirth in a Southern Irish hospital, and she happens to be called Eileen, but that doesn't make her Catholic, although it sounds like that. In fact, Ian Paisley's wife is called Eileen. And the nurses baptized her baby, presuming she was Catholic, and blessed it and gave it a name and came back to say, you know, she was sick and she couldn't get involved. And her husband was also Protestant from Northern Ireland. But both Protestant in Northern Ireland, and they couldn't believe this had happened. They lived in the Republic, they loved the Republic, but they couldn't believe this had happened. They felt affronted, infringed. And that's the sort of story that Northern Protestants have, that there's a separate culture, a separate identity. But it's a much more fundamental thing that a nation in Ulysses is... Leopold Bloom is asked about a nation, and he says, a nation?
A race, actually.
Oh, sorry, is it? The same people?
In the same place.
The same people in the same place.
For a long time.
For a long time. The same people in the same place for a long time. So you have, obviously, in Northern Ireland, two races. And you just must go along with respecting the fact that there are two of them there. The notion of a united Ireland, united what? I mean, obviously the border has lost all its power because of Maastricht. So there are no customs posts. You know, there's no... And as Europe moves on into a euro currency and into perhaps even a European passport, which I certainly hope it does, and the sooner the better, we will then find, what country are we talking about? What's era Ireland, Republic of Ireland, since we all want to be run from Brussels, which I certainly do want to be run back from. And therefore, these, you know, borders in Europe are breaking down in any case. But the notion of has very important implications in the Republic, that if you start recognizing difference, then you might start recognizing that in the Republic there are different groups, different people who want different things. So it starts there somewhere, but it's impossible to have these discussions now with bombs, because a bomb is a complete break of every trust that you might have of trying to work out something whereby you say, I want the other side to have the rights they want. I need them to have that for me to be okay. But that sort of language cannot exist at a time when small news agents are being blown up on a corner of the press.
You know, what I thought was particularly horrifying, actually, about the particular bomb is what I saw today on the news, that it was done by a guy who was 21, a guy from Gorey, County Wexford, close to where you come from. And I was thinking, he was 21 years old, and that means he was born in 1974, 75. Jeez. Actually went to school in a small town in Ireland, in the south of Ireland, and grew up, went to school there, and then went to England, and somehow managed to, if he came from Belfast, I could understand it a lot more. I found it very difficult to understand how somebody coming from the south, who was 6 years old, made his first communion after the hunger strikes in 1981, was still motivated.
I didn't know that.
Was able to do this.
That's
incredible. So, I don't know, it's really, it's very strange. Well, actually, your question raised an interesting idea in my mind. I was just talking about it with somebody today, is a burning issue in Holland is multiculturalism. And the Dutch have a big problem with it at the moment, as everybody knows. And they don't know they have. Whereas Ireland has never claimed to be multicultural. That's the problem, to some extent. In Holland, people pay lip service. They say Holland is a multicultural nation, except for Bolkestein. But a lot of other people say it is. Whereas in Ireland, the idea of multiculturalism is a really foreign idea. It's the idea of another culture within your culture that you actually learn to live with. The other culture within the Irish culture was always a culture that tried to destroy the Irish culture. So the idea that the unionists might be a people who wouldn't try to destroy you is a difficult concept, I think. And I think that kind of situation you mentioned with this girl, you get the kind of situation in Holland in the interaction between the Dutch state, for example, and Islamic groups and Islamic minorities, where the Dutch state does weird things without asking them first if it's okay. You're going to get it everywhere. except in Ireland it's a particularly bad example of it.
Yeah, I think the American example is interesting there, where the issue of race in the United States is on one hand a huge taboo that never really enters into public discourse. Then you have Clinton's inauguration, where the poet Maya Angelou appears, you know, to represent Robert Frost. In other words, Kennedy had Robert Frost, who is the ultimate, you know, dead white male. And then you get Maya Angelou, whose main work is in autobiography to try and actually get right what it was like to be black, where she was born, and as a poet as well. And that you keep finding in American race issues political correctness, that you cannot use the words. The words are what's important, first of all. Stop using them. Be really careful every word you use. So words move from the N-word we don't use anymore into black and then into Afro-American. And this becomes vitally important as a way of establishing the rights of what I still call black people in America. And the meetings, everything that happens in relation to the black question is surrounded by such subtlety now in the way people use language. I went to a launch of a book by what was called a new movement of avant-garde architects in America. I discovered that everybody in all the architects were black, and it was being held in the Harvard Club in New York, which is the most white privileged bastion. But of course the Harvard Club would nowadays be only delighted, you know, it would be really important for them to be able to say, look, we gave these people this space. And the black word wasn't used. The word used was avant-garde. And the people, you know, it was about trying to establish that there were black architects in New York, and they were sort of looking for work, basically. And the only word not used on that occasion was the B word. Nobody said black. People said everything else. And I saw this as a wonderful, you know, way of getting language, first of all, to do the work for you, and then seeing if language might actually do something more. So the business of, you know, say, Catholic, someone brought up in Ireland as a nationalist Catholic, trying to deal with a unionist, both directly and also politically. There are all sorts of ways of dealing with it, but I think the first one is about respect, and the way to do that, first of all, is through language. And then to find, since the thing is about identity, about what your passport says, what your flag looks like, rather than about your daily life. It's not about money. Therefore, it's easy to do if you can work the language. If you can get the language right, you can get a lot right. And I think the American thing is even more interesting when the OJ business comes along, like the bomb like the bombing in London. The OJ business comes along and breaks all that very carefully wrought sort of consensus into polarization and, where, I mean, really serious stuff. So that consensus is so fragile. And I just think the American race thing is always interesting in that context.
Yeah, but an interesting thing about language is, I mean, you're an Irish writer, and you write in English, and you publish in America, and you published in Britain. I mean, are you treated differently by the British publishers and American publishers to get a different kind of reaction?
The English, you see, there's a real problem in England at the moment that English novelists don't sell at all, really, much. I mean, two or three do, but in general, a first novel by an English writer will be greeted with immense disdain and people won't buy it. Whereas when they publish novels by Irish writers, they sell in Ireland because they're a form of gossip and people feel there might be news in them of some sort, which will sustain them through the long winter. And therefore, but also maybe more seriously, you get more coverage if you're Irish. So therefore, English publishers publish books by Irish writers with a guaranteed sale of some sort. So you're most welcome in England, and they're very kind and sweet, and they're full of guilt in some ways, and you can say anything you like to them. You know, my name has two accents on the surname, which is a Gaelic version of a Norman name, and they left the two accents off the book, you know, first novel. This is the mainland man, it's the same man, he's responsible. And so they sent me the proofs, and they had my name on every left-hand page, I think, and there were no accents on it. So, of course, I could be mustering up to say, well, just a moment now. He said, well, do you really need those things? So you feel like I have this guy exactly where I want him. And I said, well, actually, you know, we fought for 700 years for the right to have those things on our name. And if you think that you're going to stop me. And of course, he immediately doesn't know whether this is a joke or not. He's immediately apologetic. And the tables are turned all the time now, that English people... There's a general interest in Irish writing in England and Irishness in England and all that, because they see it as a way out of their own dilemmas. And it's a matter for jokes. If it wasn't so bloody, it would be really funny.
Yeah.
But in the meantime, it's awful.
Yeah, but what about America? Because I always thought it was very funny, because in the 1980s, when you opened American poetry magazines, they would always talk about Seamus Heaney as if he was an American poet. In fact, he was an Irish poet, was okay, but he was basically an American poet because he lived in America and so forth. But do you ever have that problem that people like Americans try to include you and say, well, Colm Tóibín, he writes books, publishes in America. Well, he's like...
No.
You don't have that?
No, I don't have that at all. The funny thing about, we always think the Irish in America did really well and, ran everything. Well, they don't have anything to do. You don't come across them in publishing at all. Mm. You wouldn't see an Irish person in publishing. I don't know, it would be an amazing idea. My editor for the Catholic book in New York is black and speaks seven languages. And I said, he was talking about minorities, and I said, well, I'm from minority, and I was saying almost as a joke, like, well, can I be included, since we're all talking about minorities, can I be included in this? He said, no, you can't at all.
That's not fair. Yeah.
Being black in America is much more serious than being Ireland anywhere, being Irish anywhere. Yeah.
That's
simple. I have a question to ask about the IRA bombing. You said earlier today that to stop the bombing, a miracle had to happen. Can you explain what miracle you expect, or what miracle should happen? Would it be America?
The nationalist side, which has gone from the IRA to Sinn Féin, the political party, to the SDLP, the other nationalist party, which is constitutional, to the Irish government, to the American government, and that sort of way of power sort of moving, kept making proposals, which the unionists kept not wanting. First of all, United Ireland said, well, no, they don't want that. Then the Irish government, some involvement in Northern Ireland, no, they don't want that. No matter what anyone said, they said no. And suddenly, they made a terrible mistake of suggesting something themselves, which was an election in the north to lead to all party talks. And suddenly, it was up to them to convince everybody, this is what we want. And if everybody, that they were suddenly becoming the persuaders for the first time since the trouble started. And that was going to be a very interesting situation. And the bomb has broken any advantage we could take from that. The bomb has no short-term advantages for the IRA, in that it will make the unionists even harder against negotiation. It will make the British even more fearful that they're dealing with the devil. So there's no possibility in the short term of the bomb having any advantage. But the bomb does have an advantage in the long term, which is that over 10 or 15 or 20 years through attrition, some British Prime Minister would say, I want out of this place now. And that's would obviously for the IRA be the most interesting solution. So you tend to see the bomb as part of a strategy. These people are not fools. They always have a strategy. They surprised everybody with the bomb. Nobody was expecting it. They were able to take the advantage of that. So they must have something in mind which is long-term. So we may be facing into a 10-year campaign, in which case, whoever is deciding on this is very hardline and very difficult to persuade, and what can you offer them? So obviously the Senator George Mitchell, who has been a hero in all of this, because he was sent by Clinton to actually write a report to try and create a set of words which everyone could agree to and go into talks, which he did. And John Major that day, what the word used by one American commentator was, junked his report in the House of Commons. Binned is the other word being used. There are those sort of words being used to what Major did. In other words, it was a day where they got a former Norwegian Prime Minister, a Canadian general, and an ex-senator in the United States together, who wrote this absolutely wonderful report, saying everybody has to give a little at the beginning, give a little during, everybody has to move. And everybody could have been forced to accept this First of all, the United States said they must accept it, and then the British and Irish government would do this, and then would move. And on that day, John Major said that they could either decommission their weapons now, which was the report had said they didn't have to do, or have an election now. In other words, it was a completely pro-unionist speech. And it was, you moved, when I heard Mitchell in the morning, he was just so wonderful, and there wasn't a word out of place. Everybody was being included in this. It wasn't about victory for any side. I thought, this is actually going to work. This is going to be wonderful. And by that afternoon, Major made me angry. And I have very little sympathy with this nationalism. So if he made me angry, I can't think what he did to them. But I'm not blaming Major for the bomb. The bomb was done by the IRA. Major was simply taking part in the great game Ireland and England has been playing with America overseeing it. And it was another step Major was taking. The problem with Major was he made a mistake. He was beginning to feel guilty. We then had him where we wanted him. You know, it was beginning to look interesting, even in the days after Major's speech. And the bomb breaks that, and it's very hard to see. George Mitchell has been back in Dublin this week. But it's very hard to see what he would say or what anybody could offer them, the IRA, now that they would accept, that would then result in a settlement. So it just looks awful at the moment. It just looks awful, really. And it is about six or seven people, the Army Council of the IRA, who nobody knows who they are. People have a pretty good idea, but sort of running something that is going to stymie every type of movement in the country, except the movement that happens in daily life, in the day-to-day thing, which, for example, in the council, the local communities in Northern Ireland, they share power all the time. Derry is run by Protestant mayor one year, Catholic mayor the next, even though the Catholics have the majority. The Catholics give the Protestants the mayor. In every local community, that's happening. But the broader picture is very depressing. And the blowing up of two men who run a corner newsagents is the least brave thing you can do, as representing a community. It's an outrage. And the problem we have is that we all join together in some way, calling it a pan-nationalist movement. And we're almost all being represented by this bomb. And it's very hard for everybody to move back, saying, it has nothing to do with us. And it's very hard for Irish people in England as well. It's very hard. I mean, I was in London last week, and the taxi driver said that he'd been threatened by the police for parking a double yellow line. They sent for the riot squad on the day of the bomb. And that sort of stuff is very difficult, because the two countries merge all the time. People are always going back and forth between the two countries. The two countries are almost the same country in certain ways. In certain ways, they're not. But at the moment, it's just really dreadful.
Are there any questions, any urgent questions from the hall? No? Good.
Thank you, Colm Tóibín and Michael O'Loughlin, for giving us your views on these American-Irish matters that were so far, at least for me, not so clear. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. Our next lecture will be in a month from now, on the 21st of March, with Ariel Dorfman. Information is in the hall. Stay a while, have a drink, have another book signed. Thank you for coming.